Agnes Davidson, later Buntine, was born in the year 1822 in Glasgow, Scotland. Her father, John Davidson, was a crofter, which was essentially a tenant farmer on a small enclosed piece of land, and her mother was a housewife called Sarah. Agnes had five younger siblings, which may have led to her being hard-working from a young age. Although information on her early life is scarce, we know she worked as a dairymaid for a time. Given her background and the era she was born in, she likely received little or no education. In 1839, the Davidson family left their home in Glasgow and boarded a ship which would take them to Australia, where they would start a new life. The exact motives for the move are unknown, but it's thought that their neighbour, Hugh Buntine, had convinced them of the idea. Furthermore, around this time, people from all across Great Britain were travelling to Australia in hopes of a better life. The majority of these were manual labourers, such as agricultural workers, domestic servants, and those of a trade. The journey to Australia was long, tiring, and arduous. Conditions on board were poor, and many people died of illnesses during the four-month journey to the other side of the world. After months at sea, the Davidson family arrived in the newly established Glen Huntly in Melbourne in April 1840. At this point in time, Melbourne was a small town, having been established just a few years prior by John Batman. He set up the town while searching for more grazing land. He explored a large area in what is now the northern suburbs of Melbourne, and on the 8th of June 1835, wrote in his journal, "So, the boat went up the large river, and I am glad to state, about 6 miles up, found the river all good water and very deep. This will be the place for a village." Following this, the town was established and slowly expanded. Agnes Davidson was now 17 years old and became a dairymaid in Glen Huntly. During this time, the Davidson family remained close to their old neighbour, Hugh Buntine. Hugh was a brick and tile maker who had only recently moved to Melbourne. Despite having migrated to Australia before the Davidsons, he originally settled in Sydney with his wife and children. However, after the death of one of their children from typhoid fever, the family relocated to Melbourne. Sadly for Hugh, typhoid fever would also be the cause of his wife's death. Following this, the 36-year-old father of five started a liaison with the Davidsons' oldest daughter, Agnes. They began a relationship and married on the 30th of October, 1840. Following the marriage, the couple established a dairy farm at Merry Creek, but money was short for the pair, so they hoped to start a more profitable livelihood. It was around this time that they heard of the resource-rich Gippsland. Despite the area being largely underdeveloped, mainly being known for its mountains and forests, the couple believed they could make a good life for themselves in the new area. When the couple left Glen Huntly, Agnes's first child was on the way. She was 7 months pregnant, and not too long after arriving in Port Albert, she gave birth to a baby boy who was named Albert after the town. By July 1842, the pair had moved to North Gippsland and constructed a quaint hut. Mainly uninhabited, they were some of the first European settlers in the area. Furthermore, their son Albert was said to be the first white baby in Gippsland. As a result, Agnes Buntine became known as Mother Buntine, or the White Mother of the Gippsland District. After this, the couple established a pub, which was also a resting place for tired travellers, called the Bush Inn. It was near the very small town of Tarraville, on the road to Sale. Although the couple did have guests, the small population in the area meant that profits weren't the best, and life was tough in this new, extremely rural place. Later, the couple also opened a general store, and Hugh, despite having no experience in the field, began to help the sick and injured in the local area. As a result, he earned the nickname Dr. Buntine. In 1845, Agnes Buntine and her husband moved to Bruthen Station. Devastatingly, it was here just 3 years earlier where the indigenous population faced one of the region's worst massacres. Records state that hundreds were murdered. Unfortunately, this was just one of many slaughterings in East Gippsland. The mass murders of the indigenous Gunaikurnai people in this area became known as the Gippsland Massacres. Henry Meyrick, a Gippsland squatter, which is a historic Australian term for someone who occupied a large tract of Crown land in order to graze livestock, wrote a letter in 1846 to his relatives back home in England, stating, "The blacks are very quiet here now. Poor wretches. No wild beast of the forest was ever hunted down with such unsparing perseverance as they are. Men, women and children are shot whenever they can be met with. I have protested against it at every station I have been in Gippsland, in the strongest language, but these things are kept very secret, as the penalty would certainly be hanging. For myself, if I caught a black actually killing my sheep, I would shoot him with as little remorse as I would a wild dog, but no consideration on earth would induce me to ride into a camp and fire on them indiscriminately, as is custom whenever the smoke is seen. They will very shortly be extinct. It is impossible to say how many have been shot, but I am convinced that not less than 450 have been murdered altogether." Whether or not Agnes and Hugh played a part in these massacres is unknown. However, it's believed that many who took part were from the Scottish Highlands. Considering the fact that around this time they got a pastoral license for 8,000 acres, as well as the Buntine Scottish heritage, there is a possibility that they were involved in one way or another. Over the next few years, the couple would continue to farm and run the pub, yet the ever-growing family was still fairly poor. Because of this, during the early 1850s, when Agnes was around 29 years old, she decided to take on a new job to help her financially struggling family. She decided to begin a carting business, transporting goods all over Victoria. In order to move the goods around, she would need a bullock team and a wagon, known as a bullock train. Back then, this was how most goods were transported to inland parts of southern Australia. Typically, this job was done by sturdy, rough men called bullockies. Although it was known to be a well-paying job, it was physically demanding, requiring stamina, skill, and strength. Yet, this didn't faze Agnes one bit. Agnes became the first and most famous female bullockie in Australia. In 1851, she undertook her first trip. Her cargo on this occasion consisted of 1 ton of cheese and 1/2 ton of butter. She single-handedly drove her team of bullockies from southern Victoria over Australia's biggest mountain range, called the Great Dividing Range. After lots of travelling, she eventually made her way to the goldfields near Bendigo, which was hundreds of kilometres away from her home near Port Albert. When she arrived, she opened a small store to sell her goods. As another gold rush began, local population started to soar. In time, she set up another store. Local businessmen realized that she was very dependable, as Agnes got the job done no matter the weather or terrain. In time, Her income would rapidly increase thanks to her daring reputation and reliability. She was known for being one of the first people to get to and traverse essentially inaccessible places. Agnes's courage was such that she would travel through mountain tracks with her team of bullockies, even though most men wouldn't even dare to travel through these areas on foot. Also, her skills with a stock whip were second to none. These were basically the bullocky's steering wheel. In order to turn, Agnes would have to crack the whip on the right animal with the correct amount of strength and precision. Moreover, during this time, Agnes gave birth to new little ones. By 1855, the pair had 5 more children, meaning they now had a family of 10. Over the next few years, Hugh continued to farm, run the pub, and look after the children. But in 1858, he became ill and quite weak. Now 54 years old, Hugh stopped farming as the couple gave up their license to Bruthen Creek. Furthermore, as Agnes was healthy and had a larger income, Hugh was able to take a step back from work while his wife transported goods all across Victoria. On one occasion, a cattle driver named J.J. O'Connor was wet and cold after a day at work when he encountered Agnes in a pub. He recalled the event stating, "I saw a boiling kettle on the fire and thought a hot whiskey would be nice. Just then, in walked this great big, rough-looking woman and the landlord introduced me. Being the only guests, we sat all evening by the fire. She didn't boast of anything she had done beyond rearing her children. I asked why she took up bullock driving, and she said she had to keep her family, and as men were making good money at the carrion trade, she thought she could do the same." As a bullocky, Agnes Buntine was described as a steam boiler on horseback. She had strong, heavy-set, almost masculine features, her clear, intense eyes being her most marked attribute. Agnes also had 2 pistols contained in her belt, and according to a man who knew her, she smoked an old black pipe. Apart from being one of the best bullockies around, Agnes was also a skilled rider, had the abilities of a woodchopper, and could wield her stock whip like no one else. One story tells that upon seeing a drunken man assaulting a young lady, she took out her whip and started lashing the drunkard until he was sober. Agnes was known to be quick-tempered. There are many articles which detail her irritable nature, such as frequent arguments with neighbors, employees, and her strong, threatening language. She was even known to occasionally whip the indigenous population. However, she has also been described at times as generous and kind. During her travels, a large bushfire set her wagons and freight alight. Initially, she tried to put the fire out, but as it spread, she threw herself on the ground until the flames died out. Fortunately, it was her unconventional dress sense that saved her life. Unlike most women of the time, who wore crinolines, bonnets, and shawls, Agnes preferred to wear short skirts, long leather leggings, thick boots, and a large jumper. Although she still received several burns from the incident, had she been wearing something else, her injuries may have been much more severe. In 1862, Agnes travelled to Walhalla, shortly after gold was discovered there. Due to the lack of roads and mountainous terrain, the journey to the town was difficult. Of course, this didn't stop Agnes. Along with her team of bullocks, she provided miners with the heavy equipment they needed, becoming the first person to transport supplies to the town. A day after arriving, she even killed one of her bullocks to feed the famished gold miners. As Hugh got older, his health deteriorated. He passed away in 1867. Following this, she continued her carting business and finally retired in 1873. That same year, she married an English farmer called Michael Hallett, who was just 29 years old. By now, Agnes was 53 years old. For the next 20 years, she lived a quiet life with her husband at Flynn's Creek, where the couple farmed. Agnes Buntine passed away in Gippsland Hospital, Sale, on the 29th of February, 1896, aged 73. She was buried in the cemetery of Rosedale, Victoria, which was the same place where Hugh had been buried. By the time of her death, four of her five children were still alive. Many of them, as well as her stepchildren, went on to become landowners in the area. Thank you everyone for watching this video on Agnes Buntine. I hope you enjoyed. If you did, leave me a like and a comment. And if you're a frequent viewer of my channel but hasn't subscribed yet, I'd really appreciate it. If you have any suggestions, please leave me a comment down below or send it to my email, which is found in the description. Anyway, that's all from me. So I'll see all of you in the next Forgotten Life. Thanks.